Hey everyone, this video is a tutorial for animating in Google Earth, specifically in the style of a John Bois video. For those who don't know, John Bois is a sports writer for SB Nation / Secret Base. They cover a lot of weird, interesting stories about athletes using charts, 3D models, and smooth jazz. His videos were a very big inspiration for my recently completed series on the physics fraud of Jan Hendrik Schön. I'll be showing you step by step how I made that video, and hopefully you can use this as a jumping off point to experiment with your own ideas. I've even linked to some of my Google Earth files in the description so you can play around with them. This video is meant to be watched front to back, but I have put timestamps in the description so you can skip ahead if you're looking for something in particular. As a heads up, Google Earth outputs video files that you'll need to chop up later in a regular video editor, in addition to adding things like narration and music. As for images, text, and 3D models, I make all of those in a separate program and then import them into Google Earth. This is a list of all the programs I use, but you can swap out any of these if you already have a preference. The first question you'll probably have is which version of Google Earth should I use? There are two options, Google Earth Pro, aka the desktop version, and Google Earth Studio, aka the browser version. These are two very different programs and your choice depends on exactly what you want to make. Both are free programs. The desktop program has existed for many years now and it's what John uses for all his videos. It's basically a downloadable version of Google Maps that has a bunch of extra features for movie making. The browser version launched in late 2018, and in order to use it, you need to fill out a quick form, but you'll get access in a day or two. The browser version is quite a bit different, and you'll notice it's set up like a full-on video editor, with robust camera options, a timeline, and keyframing features. So why use one over the other? Here's a quick list of the pros and cons. I think the desktop program is better suited for A, longer videos, say upwards of 5 minutes, or B, videos that use lots of images and overlays. The browser version is the better choice if you want to do any of the following. C, short videos with extremely complex or cinematic camera movements. D, tracking points for integration with After Effects. E, better 3D buildings and textures, which is great for emulating drone footage. For our purposes though, the most important feature is KML files. Any images, place markers, or 3D models that you put on the Earth end up getting saved in a text file that ends with either .kml or .kmz. It stands for Keyhole Markup Language and is the file format Google Earth uses to save geolocation data. Now thankfully, you don't need to know anything about coding as these files are created automatically for you. Both the desktop version and browser version support the viewing of KML files, but only the desktop version supports the creation and editing of KML files. Even if you wanted to use the browser version to view the images, you need to first create them in the desktop version and then import them into the browser version. For this reason, if you plan on using hundreds of images, it would be extremely tedious to have to switch back and forth between both versions. And to be honest, I find the desktop interface a lot more accessible to learn. I will note that the browser version is still in development and the KML features may improve in the future. But for the time being, it's not very useful for us. However, I have linked some tutorials for the browser version made by Google themselves in the description. First, adjust your screen size so that the view panel matches the resolution you want to render at. Do you want to render at 1080p? Make sure you're seeing 1920 by 1080, because if it's bigger, you might get parts of your shot cut off. The next step is to choose where on the Earth you want to make your video. This is up to you, but I suggest making sure your starting position isn't too zoomed in. You ideally want to be zoomed out enough that you can't see individual houses. At the same time though, make sure the curvature of the Earth isn't visible unless it's a desired effect. I recommend turning off all the extra layers of info that will be distracting. Border labels, terrain, and 3D buildings. Those last two will help reduce loading times, and you'll probably want a flat surface anyway. Feel free to turn these back on if you need them. To finish your setup, go to Tools, Options, Navigation, and select Do Not Automatically Tilt While Zooming. Normally when you zoom in close to the Earth, it starts to tilt into street view, but for making videos, we just want to zoom in without the tilt. Finally, this is a list of keyboard shortcuts that will make your life much easier. Feel free to screenshot this and have it open while you're learning. Making a video in Google Earth is kind of like making a 3D PowerPoint. The backbone of your video will be the images and text that you load into the Earth. Now, if you look at the top toolbar, you have a bunch of icons that represent all the different things you can add to the Earth. Let's select the two rectangles, which will add an image. This pops open a new window. First, type in a name for this overlay. Next, click Browse and select an image file. You should now see that image on top of the Earth at ground level. Feel free to adjust the position using the green plus sign in the center. You can then adjust its rotation using the green diamond on the left. To adjust its size, drag any of the green corners. To maintain its aspect ratio, hold down Shift before you drag the corners. There are many extra options in the little tabs here. The View tab will be very important as it helps us set up our camera angles, and I'll get into it in the next section. The Altitude tab is what you'd expect. Change it to Absolute, and adjust the slider. More importantly, if two images are at the same altitude, you can set the drawing order to determine which is on top of the other. A higher number means it's on top. If there's a tie for drawing order, the last thing that you've modified will be the thing that's on top. There's also a little transparency slider. Finally, you'll notice a little checkmark box next to each image in your My Places list. Click this box to toggle the visibility of an image. This will be very important later when we're recording our movie. My main advice for images is to make sure that they're big enough. I usually start by having open my image editor and having the canvas set to 1080p. That's so I can see how big the image is relative to the whole screen. Then I crop it after I'm done editing. Keep in mind, the more you have to zoom in on something, the bigger it's going to have to be, otherwise it's just going to be blurry. For an extreme example, the calendars in my fraud series are constantly getting zoomed in on, so each calendar year is in 8K resolution, which means they don't show up as blurry. Now, unfortunately, Google Earth doesn't have a built-in text feature. The closest thing it has is place marks, which is the little yellow pushpin icon. The problem is that the text scales when you zoom in and out, and also you can't change the font styles. All text in my videos are just transparent PNGs that I make using an image editor. I type out the text, set the font style and color, and get rid of the background. I usually use a size of 72 points or above for good resolution. As for 3D models, Google Earth has a very basic tool that lets you draw polygons. If you want, you can extend the polygon downwards so it looks like a 3D block. If you want to get more complicated though, you'll need to make a 3D model in an external program. For my video, I made a bunch of cylinders in SketchUp, but any program that exports as a .dae file should do. All you do is click File, Open, and select your .dae file. Some modeling programs let you export directly as a KML file, but I'd actually avoid this, as what it does is it locks in your location and size, and I bet you'll want to move stuff around, so you probably don't want that. These are all the basic elements you can import into Google Earth, and next I'll show you how to animate them. We're going to be making a long list of landmarks, and each one is going to be assigned a camera angle, aka a view. Every time you click on a landmark, it will move the camera from the current position to the new one, and this is how we animate our video. You can assign these camera angles by right-clicking on a landmark and selecting Snapshot View, which will save the current view to that landmark. You can also snapshot a view under the View tab in the Properties window. Any element that appears under your My Places list can have a camera angle assigned to it. This includes image overlays, polygons, 3D models, and placemarks. Placemarks are nice because they're kind of like an empty container whose only job it is to be assigned a camera angle. Just add it in, set the camera angle, and make sure to change the opacity of the label and icon to 0% so that nothing shows up. Here's an example using 3D text. The first step was to choose a camera angle and save it to something. Then one by one, I added each word as a different image. Then individually, I adjust the size and altitude until they lined up perfectly at this one camera angle. So if you move away and click on that camera angle, you get this really neat parallax effect where all the words come together. Google Earth, by default, will jump from viewpoint to viewpoint at a constant speed, regardless of the distance between two points. This is unlikely to be what you want, because if you're going from Asia to Europe, that's going to be very fast and hard to track. You can edit this speed by going to Tools, Navigation, and adjusting the fly-to speed either by using the slider or typing in manually. You should experiment yourself, but these are some common ranges I stick to depending on the situation. Note that you can access this menu even while you're in the middle of recording, and is necessary if you want different speeds in the same shot. Now, by default, if you're just going from viewpoint to viewpoint, Google Earth tends to zoom out, fly over, and zoom back in. Sometimes though, you just want a horizontal panning shot with no zooming. And for that, you can set up a path. Paths have their own unique camera controls, which you can access by going to Tools, Touring, and modifying the middle section here when creating a tour from a line. This lets you set a constant camera tilt, a camera range, and speed. Keep in mind you can type in whatever values you want manually, even if the slider seems like it's been maxed out. Here's a really critical thing about how Google Earth records. It's going to open up a text file and write down a series of events in order. It's then going to render those events in that specific order. Every time the camera moves, that's an event. Every time an image is made visible, that's an event. However, this becomes a problem if you want to make multiple images visible one after the other. If you just check three images in a row, Google Earth is going to record that as one simultaneous event. You need to insert a camera movement in between each of those images. You can trick Google Earth by doing the following. Assign each image the exact same camera angle. That way, Google Earth thinks a camera movement has occurred in between each image, even though all that's happening is a pause in between each image. In terms of organization, I highly recommend creating folders under My Places and grouping the place markers for each chapter of your video. Then within each folder, make sure the names are in the order you're going to click them. I use the numbering scheme 000, 001, 002, and so on. This is helpful because you can click Sort A to Z to put them in order immediately. Trust me, this will save you a major headache. The other advantage of folders is that you can toggle an entire folder on and off with a single click. Now that you've set up a storyboard for all your shots, we'll move on to actually recording the movie. To record your movie, you click the camcorder icon and press the red circle down below. Google Earth is now writing a sequence of events into a KML file, and every camera motion is going to be recorded from this point on. You're just going to go down your list of place marks, toggling images if need be, and adjusting your camera speed if desired. You can re-watch your recording to see if you're happy with it, but be aware that this is going to be a bit laggy because we haven't rendered it yet. The final render will be a lot smoother. Click the save icon to give it a name, and then click the X button. You'll have a new item in your list that you can then render into a video file. Note that you should always record a shot and render it right away, instead of recording three shots and rendering those back to back. That's because images from later shots, if you don't turn them off, will be visible in the earlier shots. To render, go to Tools, Movie Maker. Select the tour you just recorded from the drop-down list. Select the save location and file name, and then choose Custom as your video parameter. By default, Google Earth has a big watermark in the bottom right, which you should include if you're using satellite footage. If you're just using your own assets though, we can crop it out by making the video file a little bit taller than we need it to be. I set the picture size to 1920 by 1400 if I'm rendering at 1080, and 1280 by 865 if I'm rendering at 720. This gives just enough space to crop the watermark without being excessive. Next, select your frame rate. 60 is obviously better than 30, but keep in mind both your rendering time and hard drive space. I usually go with MP4 as my file type, and picture quality set to high. Now just sit back and render. Now I don't know about you, but the files Google spits out are never recognized by Windows 10 or even my video editor. To fix this, I run them through a video compressor, Handbrake. This is good because it lets us crop off the watermark at the same time, so it's two birds, one stone. Simply load in the file and choose a compression level. and manually adjust the crop to take off the excess top and bottom. For a height of 1400, take off 160 on the top and the bottom. You can check your math using the output here. Feel free to save this step for when you have a bunch of files rendered. You can queue them all up at once and just let it run while you take a break. The final step is to assemble it all in your video editor. For me, this was the easiest part of the job because it meant just chopping up the video file and syncing up the camera movements to my voice, as well as adding in the music. The video file will spend only a few frames on a given shot before moving to the next one, so I usually take a screenshot and make it the length that I need the pause to be. Also, if you have a ton of images on screen, you'll often have a single frame in your video files where an image had to load in as a gray square. Just trim out this frame and you should be good to go. Sometimes I'll speed up or slow down certain clips to make the timing easier, but try to avoid doing it more than plus or minus 15%, because past this point, the choppiness of the video file becomes noticeable. This is a very intimidating process, so hopefully this tutorial has helped you get past the tough stuff. You only get better through practice and experimentation though, and once you're in the zone, you get way faster at it. Here are some miscellaneous tips. I cannot stress this enough. Choose a flat, single color background. This is gonna save you so much time. Don't get too bogged down with the planning ahead. I'd say 80% of my Hendrik Schoen series was improvised, and some of my favorite shots were spur-of-the-moment ideas. At one point, I was just like, hey, should I make an octagon with these pictures? I haven't made an octagon yet, let's do that. That being said, it's still good to have some basic structure to act as a skeleton. For me, that was the calendars. They were a great visual device, the colors provide nice contrast, and it meant I didn't always need to think about where I was going to put the next image. If something happened in April 2002, it has to go in that box, so I could get creative within that restriction. Next, I highly recommend choosing music for your video beforehand. You don't need to have every song locked in, but finding a couple songs for dramatic moments in your video helps set the tone, and you can even edit to the beat. Next, don't go overboard and add too many camera motions. If the screen is constantly moving, it can be distracting for the viewer, especially if there's a lot of text. Another example would be my fancy 3D text for the chapter breaks. They look super neat, but they also take a while to plan and they lose their impact if you overdo it. Save the fancy stuff for when it really counts to hammer home those dramatic moments. Finally, a critical disclaimer. Google Earth is not an animation software, and we're making it do stuff it was never meant to do. Even when you think you planned it perfectly, there is an inherent amount of jank that will just make it into your movies, and that's something you have to accept. There are many shots where the camera motion looked great, right until the last few frames where it kind of jerks in a rotating motion. A few of you pointed it out, and trust me, I'm aware, I hate it when it does that, but the only way to kind of get rid of it is to reshoot everything and slightly tweak the camera angles, and at a certain point, that's just too much work and you have to live with it. Anyway, that's all the advice I have for you. If you have further questions, please feel free to leave them in the comments. I've linked my videos on Jan Hendrik Schoen here, as well as some of my favorite John Boys videos as inspiration. Thanks for watching. Hope you have a good one.